Welcome to Caribbean Insight. We have an explosion of Caribbean videos lined up for you. Tonight, you'll be experiencing international artists displaying the cultural rhythms of soca, calypso, reggae, dancehall, and salsa. So relax, and let's take a ride down the Caribbean.
Caribbean Inside, Caribbean Inside, Caribbean Inside, please check Caribbean Inside.
I am Ras Shortyai. I am a scientist, a musical scientist. I invented soca so that Caribbean people could have something to identify with wherever they go, any part of the world.
Whoa, yes, this is Randy Isaac, the original 6'9" man. And whenever I'm in New York City, I look at Caribbean Insight, the greatest soca show on earth. Yes.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Caribbean Insight. As you know, this is the show where we keep you, the viewers, abreast of the music that's coming out of the Caribbean, calypso and soca. On this edition of Caribbean Insight, I'll be chatting with a brother who has been crowned 5 times Calypso Monarch of Trinidad and Tobago, World Calypso Monarch in New York twice, and 8 times in St. Thomas. He's been the 6-time winner of the Bi Local King. He's a great writer and historian. One of the most controversial calypsonians, I should say, coming out of Trinidad and Tobago, who hits where it really hurts. Ladies and gentlemen, Caribbean Insight is proud to present Dr. Hollis Liverpool, known in the calypso business as Chalkdust. Chalky, I want to welcome you to the show.
Pleasure is mine. Pleasure is mine.
Okay. Listen, the name Chalkdust, let's start from right there. Give me the history on that sobriquet, Chalkdust.
Well, you're starting from the roots, eh?
Yes.
Well, Chalkdust originally was a book written by a sociologist called De Wilton Rogers, who was one of the pioneers of the People's National Movement. And he wrote a book called Chalkdust. He happened to be my teacher. He was one of my teachers at Trinity College. And in teaching, I learned about that book, Chalkdust. The book, as it were, captures teachers in the denominational system. You know, teachers long ago used to work under the denominational system where priests used to be a boss and a priest could send you home at any moment. And so he wrote that book called Chalkdust, in which he was trying to show the problems of teachers under the denominational system. Mm-hmm. And when I began to teach, I got into trouble under the denominational system. So I call myself Chalkdust.
Chalkdust.
Also, Chalkdust is the least important thing in the classroom. The most important thing being the children. So in my humility, I call myself Chalkdust.
The dust that falls from the chalk.
That's all right.
Okay. Where and when did it all begin for you?
It all began for me. Calypso all began for me as a student, as a schoolboy. I was one of the elite boys, as it were, from belonging to the elite class, going to St. Mary's College and playing football, etc., and playing all the sports. And we happened to be playing intercall. You know, intercall in those days was a big thing.
Football, yeah.
Football. Mm-hmm. St. Mary's versus QRC. Mm-hmm. And I used to be the composer for the St. Mary's side. We used to prepare calypsos to sing at in intercall. Send your sons to CIC and your dogs to QRC.
Oh, okay.
What St. Mary's win this year? Whole box of dainty underwear and things like that. So we used to compose calypso like that, you know. And I was one of the composers. So it began there for me, composing calypsos to sing for intercall.
Okay.
And that's where my calypso career began. Of course, the tradition rubbed off on me afterwards when I began to hear radio and Beginner and Attila and all those guys. Mm-hmm. And I went to training college to learn to teach. Because in those days, you had to go to training college first.
Right.
And I went to training college, and in training college, I began to sing calypsos and above all, to study the history of Trinidad and Tobago. And studying the history of Trinidad and Tobago, I began to study calypso.
So that's where I began. All right, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, let's go to the videotape and pull something from the archives of Chalky while you look, listen, and learn.
Now that this calypso show is being heard on video, I'm telling opportunity to remove some false images of we. So all you people listening out there in London, France, Boston, Canada, there are many misconceptions out there. All you just hear that affair from Trinidad and Tobago, brother, we are not a part of Jamaica. Though we sing reggae, that a we culture is pan and kite so dear. So when you hear Arabella Ponte and Poindexter, that is not Kaiso, that is brandy mixed with water. And don't you think that Mighty Sparrow is the only king of Kaiso? There's also Kitchener, the grand master of Calypso. Tonight there are eight Trinis here in this ring, but we are not the only ones who could sing. So Urban Hall must bring in Kitch and Black Stalin. Oh yeah, so it's time you know the right things about Trinidad alive. Posing in Canada as refugee, that's a misconception they're fooling you with. So as to get citizenship, and all them criminals up in Brooklyn, it's not Trinidadians doing the killing. We don't fight, we don't fuss, and when we cuss, we just say Paul, and that's all. We go to New York, to Chicago, to stay. We are not Haitians, we don't run away. We are not from Bosnia, where men die like mice. We come from paradise. And like England, we have a female speaker with some clout. Our female speaker does watch big pig men and kick them out. And if you see we police marching, we'll be there against Prime Minister Manning. For carnival, them and Manning, liming and drinking. Abu Bakr staged a coup there, but Abu Bakr, we no longer fear. For this year, he was in the audience sipping ginger beer. So it's time you know the right things about Trinbago alive. Misconceptions. Shorty, a resident of TNT. When you hear Pan on Sesame Street, it's not Bert and Ernie who beat him sweet. That steel band is the creation of our land, not Japan. We are the only country in the world, I say, where government ministers just raise their pay. And as Calypsonians launch the attack, they just pay back. And Americans say our senior hall is the best comedian. But I say he can't touch the shoes of our Tommy, Joseph, and Sprangalang. And if you see on our TV a man with a neck under a lady, he's not assaulting she, he's just dancing the donkey. Michael Jackson, please come down here. Change your misconceptions about being fair. come and play my silver sun and get back your color. Oh yes, so it's time you know.
It's happening here on Caribbean Inside. Remember, pick up the phone, call a friend, call a neighbor. Let them know that Caribbean Inside has the flavor. And we'll be right back with much more.
Greetings from TNT. I am Tigress.
This is the original dance master.
This is Marshall Montana.
I'm Brother Valentino.
This is Marcia Miranda.
Caribbean Inside. Yes, I watch them all the time. They're bad.
Caribbean Inside. Really is dynamite. Caribbean Inside. Really super. Was spite. Caribbean Inside. Enjoy day or night. Caribbean Inside.
That was a good one. Ladies and gentlemen, get prepared. This half an hour is filled with information, information that you need to know. I'm Chalky. Well, you're really known for your political satires and social commentaries. That's the role you take as a Calypsonian. But when you started out as a teacher during that time, it was forbidden for civil servants to become Calypsonians. How did you, or what made you defile that law and decide, but look, I'm a teacher, but I'm going to be a Calypsonian?
But first of all, when you say it was forbidden, one has to understand that it was not forbidden by law.
Oh, this was not a law.
It was not a law. It was forbidden by custom. That is, because of this kind of values that we hold in the Caribbean, and because of the kind of values placed upon Calypso and Steelman, people of middle class, upper class persons did not participate in Steelman or in Calypso. Because the Steelman and the Calypso came from the lower class people. And Trinidad had that class system whereby people didn't identify with the lower class. Upper class and middle class didn't identify with lower class. It was all through enslavement. So when I began to sing calypsos, I was looked upon as doing lower class activity. Just like how Sparrow sang, Calypsonians really catch hell for a long time. Mm-hmm. To associate yourself with them was a big crime. If your sister talk to a steel band man,
your family want to break she hand.
Put she out, lick out every teeth in she mouth, pass your outcast. Right. So I was an outcast. Right. And so I began to sing calypso. How could a teacher, whereby the school carried middle class values,
right,
sing a lower class activity? Right. And so because of that, people castigated me, and the government of the day felt that it was wrong. And so I was dismissed. I was the only Calypsonian in the history of the Calypso who has been dismissed for taking part in the culture of the country.
What do you mean dismissed? What do you mean? Explain.
Dismissed, meaning asked to explain my position and actually dismissed from teaching because you couldn't be carrying that kind of value to our children. And so I was dismissed, but I won my case. When the Prime Minister of the day made a statement, he said, I don't know what they're bugging the young man for.
Are we talking about Eric Williams? Yeah? Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. And that caused them to reinstate me. But I kept on singing because I felt that having understood the culture is bigger than a man. The culture supersedes class. And right. So I kept singing, knowing the history, the strength, and the importance of the calypso.
Okay.
And that's why I kept singing.
Did that cause any social change? Did this cause a big social revolution this field? Tell us about it.
It caused people to look again at calypso. It caused people to look at calypso. It caused calypsonians to look at themselves. And it caused other calypsonians who were in the public service, who were in the fire services, and the other aspects of the police, and the policemen, etc. I remember Supreme Happiness coming across. I remember Ms. Bob, who was in Tobago in the fire services. He's somewhere in New York right now. All of them coming out of their shell and beginning to sing calypso. So where before the calypsoans were confined to persons without any presence in the public service, any profession.
Right.
It caused professionals
right.
to come out now and start saying Calypso. And it caused government now to take a different look.
Okay.
All it right. changed the whole, it was a revolution in thinking.
Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the videotape. While you look, listen, and be entertained by one of the living legends of Calypso, Chalkdust.
I meet a preacher from New York in Trinidad. And come quite down there. He tell me that he came down there running from New York, you know. For New York is heaven, but New York is hell also. One day in New York, you in high heaven. The next day, it's just hell for citizens. The preacher tell me, if you live in Giuliani's palace, overlooking the sea, you are walking in heavenly bliss. But if you happen to be living in some small rat hole in Brooklyn, with German cockroach ringing your doorbell, bet your life you're living in hell.
It's heaven on one side, heaven on the next side.
New York. At Reverend Sharpton with Zion. The preacher say in New York, if you're on welfare, well, welfare, son, is nothing short of hell up there. What if you had no jacket or coat in winter? You're sure to meet the devil on Flatbush, brother. When Giuliani and Petapi were elected in New York, with angels in heaven, both of them walked. But while the both of them were ringing St. Peter's bell, poor Mario Cuomo and Dinkins went down to hell. They bringing in them Russian Jews and making them U.S. citizens. So all them Russian Jews are now living in heaven. But Caribbean folks who had hard, waiting 9 years to get a green card, no house, no land, you have to hide as well. Bet your land you're living in hell.
In heaven on one side,
New York,
and heaven the next side.
So at the appellate court with Zion. To heaven. He said that Clinton does always talk about heaven, but his welfare bill might take all of us to hell, my friend. He said, when you see New York street, walk on any street. If there you will see where heaven and hell does meet. You must pay tax, but if you are not a U.S. citizen.
This is Caribbean Insight, the place where history flows and knowledge grows. And I'll be right back with much more.
This is Shalane Hendrickson-Thomas.
It's me again, the Ivan.
Hi, I'm John T.
Hi, my name is Kevin King.
This is Ramraji Prabhu.
Keep tuning in. It's the best Caribbean soca program right on, and it's happening. Love you. Stay away from drugs. Love up the soca.
Caribbean Inside. Caribbean Inside. Caribbean Inside. Please check Caribbean.
Dr. Eric William was the Prime Minister at that time. And you made it your business, I should say. Every year, you made calypsos that directly attacked this man. And he came out every year, you know he was in the Savannah, to listen to these calypsos. Was there a conflict, a personal conflict going on between you two guys at this time?
Well, actually, myself and Eric Williams, we were good friends.
Yes.
He had a very he held me in high esteem.
Explain.
Meaning that he thought well of me.
Okay.
I can give you examples upon examples if I had the time.
Right.
Of the great esteem in which Eric Willem held me. He would send for me to discuss things. He would send for me to discuss programs. He would send for me to, for example, I was the secretary of the Calypso Association. And he would send for me, send the jeep for me with all the soldiers to explain or to talk to me about his 5-year development program and the part of culture in the program, etc.
Right.
So he held me in great esteem.
Mm-hmm.
And I attacked Eric Williams not because I hated Eric Williams. I attacked Eric Williams not because I disliked Eric Williams. I attacked Eric Williams because of tradition. That is, the Calypso was always seen as the mouthpiece of the people.
Right.
Speaking about ills in the society. What I did was not to attack Eric Williams per se, but to bring to Eric Williams the problems of the day. To bring to Eric Williams some of the things that the politicians did not see. To bring to Eric Williams the parliament of the people. The PPP, the Poor People's Party.
Right.
In other words, I brought to Eric Williams things that other persons did not bring to his thinking and to his view.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I did. Some people saw it as a personal attack. It was never a personal attack. It was an attack upon the privileged position that he held as Prime Minister.
Mm-hmm.
But it was not anything personal because he respected me and I respected him. I learned from him and he learned from me, I hope. and the thing is that he was a genius of a historian. He made me do history. His documentation of history is beyond repute.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, he told me one day, there was a historian called Tannenbaum who passed through Trinidad, who was attacking some of his theories. And you know, he told me, he says, whether he be a world historian, even a historian, a Latin American historian, he's so that he was a genius of the art of documentation. Some historians say things without documenting it, without showing where the documentation comes from.
Right.
And
right.
Eric Williams taught the world in writing history, like C.L.R. James, how to write proper history. So I learned a lot from him.
You learned a lot from him.
In fact, I was a student at Trinity College,
mm-hmm.
and we were discussing 1848. A turning point in European history. And he walked into the college and we were discussing that 1848 was a turning point in European history. And I was in the opposition saying 1848 was not a turning point in European history. I said a turning point is saying that history moves like this, bam, to bam.
A change.
Right. And I was saying, it's not a change, it's a gradual change. Things that, it's like the steel band. Steel band didn't start in 1935 or 1937 or 38. Mm-hmm. Steel band started with Africans, since Africans came to Trinidad. Because that rhythm pattern, that beating, it's a slow change and change until you get a steel band.
Right, from so the tambu-bambu we come out with now.
We change, moving.
Right.
So I'm saying that 1848 is not a change. It's not an abrupt change. It's a slow, gradual change in history of concepts and thinking and ideas and themes.
Mm-hmm.
And Eric William tapped me on my shoulder. And Hollis Liverpool, the historian, was born.
Ah, okay.
So where you want to get Hollis Liverpool, the medical doctor?
Mm-hmm.
I became Hollis Liverpool, the historian.
So Eric William was responsible for your change in direction?
Yes, in a big way.
In a big way.
I wanted to be a medical doctor.
Okay.
I was cut out to be a medical doctor. I passed my common entrance, but not common entrance in those days, what do you call it, exhibition in them days.
Right.
To be a medical doctor. I got in the first 100 at Nelson Street Boys. I came from the elite class of bright people, as I told this man, bright like a bulb.
Like a 101 bulb.
Yeah.
Okay.
I could be a doctor, a medical doctor. And Eric Williams turned me from medicine into history.
Showed you the value of history and the importance of history. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the archive while we continue to be entertained, informed, and educated by Dr. Hollis Liverpool out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago.
A white man complained to me about black people in Brooklyn. How they abusing drugs and the white people they mocking. He said the folks from the Caribbean are only pimps and touts in his land. Immigration should send them back to their homeland. I told this white man, mister, you have a brain concussion. You mixing up West Indian with Afro-American. Tobota we, maybe Brooklynese. Culture makes us different, if you please. Caribbean and black American come like chalk and cheese. I said, if you see a black man eating from a hot dog stand and buying all the food and grocery in can, and big Christmas Day man, he buy McDonald's eating old ham, that, my friend, is black America. But if you see another man with a roti in his hand and buying saltfish and pigtail from them Korean, and for Christmas he's shipping man 4 barrels back to his homeland, you talking about a Caribbean man. But you want to send them back. Where you say?
Send them back.
Well, if the West Indian man go back to his homeland, the subway dead, no transportation. No more dollar cab, no bus drivers you'll have, and all them Korean go starve. White man, Caribbean people, easy to see. Mister, look for a man playing drum, all fours, oh a little roomy. We came here for an education, or for a better occupation, to improve the economic situation. And afterward, we go home to play music, to relax. Everybody, mister, go to my shaku, mister, it's for party, kitchen, trophy. So, mister white man, I beg you please, don't mix me up with them black Yankees. But are we from the same plant, same root, but it's different leaves? I said, if you see a black man with $1 million watch on his hand, driving a BMW 90 miles a second. He has no house, no savings plan, but hit TV bigger than the gas station. That, my friend, is
Black America.
But if you see another man just 2 years after he landed, he done buy a house and stop renting from the Jew man. And though his children beat him still bad, he's back to college after their vacation. You talking about a Caribbean man? But you want to send them back. Where you say?
Send them back.
You know what to do. Pick up the phone, dial someone, tell them to tune in, and I'll be right back with much more.
I'm the Lord Kitchen.
This is Rootsman.
This is Sonel Dempster.
My name is Winston Bailey, better known as Shadow.
This is Calypsonian Squeezy.
I watch no other but Caribbean Insight.
Caribbean Insight really is dynamite. Caribbean Insight really super was spite. Caribbean Insight, enjoy day or night. Caribbean Insight really is dynamite.
Hollis, let's continue here. One of the themes, as I've been looking at your work, listening to it, you know, as you continued through your repertoire, has been the fact that Calypso has changed. You talked about in the early days there were certain requirements to be a Calypsonian. You had to know to write. You had to have the ability to write. You had to be able to play a guitar or a piano or a banjo, some sort of musical instrument. You had to be able to extempo in case if you forget a line.
All right.
Also, you have to have that ability to do great rendition.
Yeah.
And put over your songs. But those are no longer requirements.
Good point.
Why is this so?
Well, I'm glad you began by saying that you got the change. The yeah. change in the Calypso is inevitable. Mm. That is, things change. The Calypso catches at changes in society. Mm. We change from single line Calypsos, mm-hmm. like Lavery Calypsos. Where the man, where the hammer gone? Tell them where they gone. Call and response Calypsos.
Call and response.
We change them that into what we call 8-line minor key Calypsos, Sandy Mandy Calypsos.
You gotta explain.
If I had my guitar, I would give you.
Okay, all right.
Between us, 16 bars. Mm-hmm. Calypsos, double tone calypsos, call them double tone.
Right.
We move from the minor key into the major key. Six, same 16 bar. Major. Then they move into the 4-line calypsos. Matilda.
Matilda, she take me money and run Venezuela.
4-line.
Mm-hmm.
Take me. I am feeling lonely. Take me down to La Sierra. Don't let me mama know. That's right. Tiger. 4 lines. So we move into the 4-line calypsos. Then we move afterwards back into the 8-line major key as chorus. And then we join the 16-bar major key with the 8-line major key, verse and chorus in the 50s. We have always been changing. Change is inevitable. Mm-hmm. We have pulled Spanish rhythms, French rhythms, Latin American chords, jazz chords. We have put all into calypso. Mm-hmm. It's always changing. What has happened, however, is that the roots of the calypso remain deeply African, and the branches and the leaves have been changing all the time. Mm-hmm. But the African roots remain. Okay. But in the calypso, where the calypsonians function now, have been changing, whereby the calypsonians were able to exploit that change into learn to extempo. You have to be able to, you have to be a Calypsonian, you have to extempo. You have to learn to play a musical instrument because you'll find yourself in a bar and they'll ask to sing a Calypso. So you have to be able to strum a guitar.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And if you can strum a guitar, you can be a Calypsonian because you have to sing for groups, you have to sing for tourists. Mm-hmm. So you have to be able to play the guitar or a quattro.
Right.
And then today you meet a German tourist, tomorrow you meet a Swedish tourist. So you have to extempo. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn the art of extempo. You have to learn all of that.
Right.
You have to learn how to sing the different themes because they are in the tent, they used to have what they call a change of theme. Mm-hmm. So you couldn't sing a whole one Calypso for the whole season. You had to change. So all that brought out different skills in the Calypsonians. Mm-hmm. But today now what is happening is that a Calypsonian makes one record and becomes famous because one record and he sings it all the time. So what I'm saying in this Calypso Quaxon and Village, which I just showed here.
Yeah, Quaxon and Village.
It's to show you that a lot of guys jump into the art form without understanding the demands of the art. Okay. And the art form calls for guitar playing, extempo singing, etc. Mm-hmm. All that is needed to being a good Calypsonian. You have to understand the art, you have to understand your function in the art form. And a lot of guys who don't understand that. That's what I'm saying in the Calypso.
Is Calypso in trouble?
Calypso is in trouble in a certain way. That is, many of us are losing the tradition. Now, when I say many of us are losing tradition, some guys jump to me and say, well, you can't be the old time thing. No. The Englishman never forgets his tradition. In the Caribbean, and I'm going to say this very slowly, we have traditions that go back to Africa, and we want to lose them overnight. Whereas the Englishman keeps his tradition for centuries, we want in the Caribbean to take our traditions and just dump them overnight. That is, we want to take the things that our ancestors have given us and just throw them away. And it can't happen. It must not happen. Because when we dump traditions, we dump our ancestors. We dump the thoughts of our ancestors. So I'm saying traditions are important. It is traditions that make the Calypso. That is, what makes jazz? It is certain traditions built around jazz.
Right.
What makes reggae? Certain traditions dump around reggae. What makes it dub? What makes the Polish polka? Certain traditions, it's 3-4 tempo, it's done in a certain way, etc. It makes it into a polka. What makes the Calypso? It is a number of traditions. And these traditions characterize the Calypso. We can't take these traditions and dump them. When we dump them, we no longer have the Calypso. According to Poza, you have something else, but not Calypso.
Not Calypso.
You see? So I am very strong on traditions.
Right.
Because I understand what traditions meant to our people. Mm-hmm. And we can't just take them and discard them. Mm-hmm. Our children must have the benefits of our ancestors' thoughts mm-hmm. and feelings. That's my point.
Okay, I agree with you 100%. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the videotape. While you continue to be educated by Dr. Hollis Liverpool out of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago.
I jumped on tower, there I happened to pass. Then a old chap, the Calypso man, was holding a Calypso class. Young soca and rapso singers sat on the ground, spellbound. The old test was telling youngsters, today's Calypsonians are wrong. The old test stuck back, lad, and said, trouble with young Calypsonians today. They have sweet voice, sweet bass, and nice melody, but no rhyming ability. The lyrics of Calypso, they sing it in time, but oh Lord, so come many a rhyme. The old man say, footsteps on the ground, footsteps on the ground.
That rhyming is strong.
Roof, roof, who let the dogs out? The dogs barking,
but that's a rhyming.
But if you run past you with Clico and run Pande with Dupre and then run Ish with Licorice, the audience bound to say
something funny say.
Sister Pamka run with Pande,
something funny say.
Mm-hmm.
Duffy, Hatton, Coon, and the crowd started to grow. Says time, all you learn the tune of choo-choo calypso. Children, long time in calypso. Good rhyming make for sweet love way. And when you rhyme, and rhyme sweet for so, the cover shouts and the manite. But today, in all your soca, all you just stringing words together. The chords that all you use in man is sweet for so. But chords is not calypso. A kaiso is a story sung in 2/4 time, using lyrics sublime in rhyme. Then he chime on the count of four. Please raise your hand and I'll boy in song.
That rhyming is strong.
Toro, toro. And then charge is song genuine.
But that's a rhyming.
But if you rhyme with that board in fraud, and the airport dropped with corrupt, and in Cochin with a short pants friend, you and all will say
Santi Manite.
Deborah Mormigis and Robbie can't rhyme in no way.
Santi Manite.
Yeah, song, the old man say, the audience must comprehend the message you want to convey, though you're disguising it, children. So if you use the word rice market and then rhyme it with racket, the audience must see the mathematics of your rhyming lyrics. And when Assam goes with Sister Pam, both of them don't talk, that's cause for alarm. And go education, but rhyme with Nanan. That rhyme is a wrong paradigm. Well, the word paradigm made me draw closer. Is then a made out Lord pretender. And pretty say, white tongue does ride a bike, he's so poor. Poor and white tongue.
That rhyme is wrong.
Manning is in love with his friend Rowley. Rowley and Manning.
Them two will rhyme.
But if you rhyme the AG with Dolce D, and Dr. Rupert Griffith with Miss Smith, and Dr. Lass with Judas, the audience come to say
Santi Manite.
Well, the word media could never rhyme with Panday.
Santi Manite.
Crowd advice about rhyming intelligently. Like Trey Price, rhymes with bad rice, and you are being with refugee. He said when White Tongue was young, he went to school new tongue and got all his songs them wrong. And when he grow up, you expect him to check his check, but his additions get incorrect. And when you're rhyming, make sure you're right, and don't you attack people for spite. So don't mix a Pral Maraj with Ramesh Maraj, or confuse them with Sat Maraj. One of them don't is selfish and does talk rubbish, so please distinguish which is which. Then he said, on the count of four, please raise your hand, and I'm going song.
That rhyme is wrong.
Take out your kerchief and wave your flag. Flag waving,
but that's your rhyming.
But if you rhyme sea ball with bubble, and Rad Singh with gun toting, and for her nightcap is one slap, the audience bound to say
Santi Manite.
Well, Alois can't rhyme with Sparrow, neither Dupre.
Santi Manite.
We'll be right back.
When you're looking for Caribbean culture and history, you can depend on the number one show, Caribbean Insight. I'm your host, Lady V. And if you're just joining us, remember, you're tuning to the show where history flow and culture glow.
I'm Super Blue. My name is Gypsy.
My name is Barry Simon. This is The Messenger.
Nobody touch your dial now.
Glenn Washington says so.
Caribbean Insight. Depth.
Caribbean Insight. Caribbean Insight. Caribbean Insight. Please check Caribbean Insight.
Chalky, I want to thank you for coming on the show.
The pleasure was mine.
And as you continue, because listen, you're now a great historian, a philosopher, a writer, educator. I know you're going to be around for a long while when you're in New York. Feel free to come and visit us. Fill us in on what's happening with the Carnival Institute. Let us know about the progress, what's going on, and wherever we can help you. Yeah, you know we're right there.
I shall do that.
Okay. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, to you, my fans and critics out there, I say to you, God bless, and I'll see you next week, same time, same place.
Get up, Kitchener, cause the whole nation to mourn. Tears flowed like a river for a noble soul passed on. Trainees at his funeral showed how much they loved the man. For like a mini carnival, they sent him off to heaven, amen. But if we love Kitchy, we must change entirely. All the things he despised, and promote the things Kitchy idolized. For instance, all you quacks who sing in stupidness for Calypso, and all you Jamaicans who born in Togo, if you love and respect Kitchy as the grandmaster, at least make one sense, some with sense this year. You promoters who this year have two queens in Calypso, are talking point blank to and Jack and Tuco, stop the puppy show. Two young kings, two queens, and two soccer monarchs will turn out to be a pig. So have one Calypso queen for Kitchener's sake. Oh yes, I beg you, have one Calypso queen for Kitchener's sake. Was an early orphan. No money, no Christmas toy, yet he made himself a man. So come you street cleaners, vagrants and homeless women, live your life like Kitchener then, on folks he never depend. Amen. And when you're faced with failure, please remember Kitchener, and with hard work and prayer, like him, you'll be great in the future. You're there. Kitchener sang this year quite on with the money gone, cause he was concerned with waste of public funds. 100 million lost in Queen's show and world beat, and next 30 million lost in rice that nobody eat. A million loss again to fight the chief justice. And then rat sing you out, boys, eating we interest. So if you love Kitchener, why Tom must answer, make no mistake and say, money gone for Kitchener's sake. Oh yes, my